Two men will be working together in the field, and one will be taken, the other left. Two women will be going about their household tasks. One will be taken, the other left. So be prepared, for you don't know what day your Lord is coming.
Life was filled with guns and war, and everyone got trampled on the floor. I wish we'd all been ready. Children died, the days grew cold, a piece of bread could buy a bag of gold. I wish we'd all been ready. There's no time to change your mind. The sun has come, you've been left behind. A man and wife are sleeping there. She hears a noise and turns her head. He's gone. I wish we'd all been ready. Two men walking up a hill. One disappears and one's left standing still. I wish we'd all been ready. There's no time to change your mind. The sun has come.
And rebuke strong nations afar off, and they shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nations shall not lift up a sword against nation, neither shall they learn war any more. Peace be unto you, right? Peace be unto you, the gospel of peace. But they shall sit every man under his vine and under his fig tree. So this is, for me, this is just, it's so profound, because in Revelation 6, and verse 13, I'm seeing, well, it says that the untimely figs are the stars of heaven. So what's the fig tree? What's the fig tree? And here, this is telling me that the church, the Hebrews, the 144,000, if they're all the same, but it's the same place. It's all in Zion, the mountain of God. It's all happening at the same place. And all of them are going to sit under his vine and under his fig tree. It says the word his. So does that mean every man has his own vine and every man has his own fig tree? And we absolutely get more scripture about this. 1 Kings 4, so King Solomon was king over all Israel, and these were the princes which he had. H8269, captains, princes, I'm being led to think, his archangels. So 1 Kings 4 is, for me, it's Solomon and Israel at their very peak. At their very peak. He had dominion all over the region, and everybody had peace. Peace be unto you. And Solomon's wisdom excelled, the wisdom of everybody, and they came from afar to hear the wisdom of Solomon. But in verse 25, we get this. And Judah and Israel dwelt safely, every man under his vine and under his fig tree, right? So we get it again. So as I say, I'm being led to think that this is where everything is just how it should be in the Old Testament. Solomon was king at his peak. He had all of this wisdom. Everybody came from afar to hear the wisdom of Solomon. It's perfect. Everybody is at peace. The land is at peace. And everybody dwelt under his vine and under his fig tree, right? So we come back into Micah 4, and this tells me that this is no longer going on. But they shall sit, every man, under his vine and under his fig tree. And this, for me, is absolutely talking about the Lord Jesus Christ and the church. So it's not happening anymore, because this is a prophecy about what was happening back in the days of Solomon when the land had rest. So it seems to me that every man has his own vine and his fig tree, and that's dependent on mankind's relationship with the Holy Spirit and with sin. Because here, the Lord gave Solomon everything. He gave Solomon everything, but Solomon, we all know, did a complete 180. And I'm being led to think potentially that's what caused. That's what caused every man to be no longer be living under his vine and fig tree. And that's where we find ourselves in Micah 4, where these things having to happen again is a prophecy, right? But we get even more. We come back into Joel, right? So Joel again. Joel 1, and it's talking about he hath laid my vine waste, right? So this is talking about the vine of the Lord, the fig tree of the Lord. And in verse 12, we get it again, right? The vine is dried up, the vine, right? And the fig tree languisheth, the pomegranate tree, the palm tree also, and the apple tree, even all the trees of the field are withered. Why? Because joy is taken away from the sons of men. So in Micah 4, it's a prophecy that every man's going to be sitting under his vine and under his fig tree. And for me, when everybody was at peace in the Old Testament, that's what we were looking at. Every man was dwelling under his own vine and under his own fig tree. And in Micah, it's now a prophecy, and every man has his own, his vine, his fig tree. And that's what we're getting in 1 Kings 4 as well. Every man under his vine and under his fig tree. But back in Joel 1, it's a little bit different, because it's talking about a singular vine and a singular fig tree, right? So in Revelation 6:13, and the stars of heaven fell unto the earth, even as a fig tree, right? Casteth her untimely figs. So this is telling me that the stars of heaven are being referred to as figs, untimely figs, and the connections I've been making with the Pharisees in Mark 11. So the fig tree is casting off stars here. That's what this is telling me, the fig tree. So we've got a singular fig tree that's casting off stars, and I'm being led to think they're potentially the scribes, the chief priests, and the Pharisees, right? So we've got the singular fig tree. So it's a fig tree, but it's not the fig tree, but it's a fig tree. It's a fig tree. Now, this is a parable. It's not literal, but I'm being led to think that when we read this, that when we read about figs and fig trees, it's at least worthy to test in these scriptures that that's what it's referring to. So whenever we read about figs, we're reading about stars. We're reading about stars, because I see that in those scriptures where we see that even as it's referring to what was before. It's describing that after it as what was before it, right? So I'm being absolutely led to think here that we're talking about figs. Figs here plainly. Figs here plainly are being referred to as stars. It's the other way around. Stars are being referred to as figs, right? So it's plain here in Revelation. This is a question I've asked quite a few times before on my videos, is that when we read something plainly in the New Testament, does that then give us confidence that that's how we're meant to be reading right through the Old Testament? Earthen vessels, for instance, Paul plainly says that they're people. they're people. We have treasure in those earthen vessels. So does that mean that's what they were in the Old Testament? And if they're not that, what are they? And why are they being called the same things, right? So when we see this here in Revelation 6:13, I'm being led to think that it's absolutely worthy to consider, to test, which I do in those scriptures, that figs are actually stars. So what's the fig tree? That then begs the question, right? So what's the fig tree? So we come back into Joel 1, and we're reading that the vine is dried up, and the fig tree, it languisheth. The fig tree languisheth, right? So that to me is that's a dying fig. That's a dying fig tree, right? And that's the scene. That's the absolute scene that we're getting in Mark 11, when the Lord Jesus Christ, he's condemning the fig tree to hell. No man eat the fruit of this tree hereafter forever. And in the morning, after he went into the temple and condemned them, and they wanted to kill him, the scribes, the chief priests, they saw the fig tree and it was dried up from the roots, right? Because I'm being led to think that it's dead and it's casting off her untimely figs, and the untimely figs are the scribes and the chief priests, right? So we've got a fig tree here that's dried up from the roots. It's dried up from the roots. So we come back into Joel 1 and we've got a fig tree that languishes, right? And it also reminds me of Jude, where we're reading about the wandering stars, and the wandering stars are being described as trees whose fruit withereth, without fruit, twice dead, plucked up from the fruits, raging waves of the sea foaming out of their own shame, they're wandering stars. So it's not referring to a fig tree per se, but it's absolutely talking about a tree whose fruit withereth, and that tree, that fruit, plucked up by the roots, so both. So we've got a tree that's twice dead, that's plucked up by the roots, whose fruit is withering. And in Joel 1, we've got a languishing fig tree. And in Mark 11, we've got a fig tree that's been dried up. That's been dried up from the roots. It's been dried up from the roots. And in Revelation 6, we've got a fig tree that's casting off her untimely figs. So we've got a singular fig tree. So there's absolute parallels going on here, right? But back in Joel 1, we've got a singular fig tree that's languishing. Now this is absolutely fascinating. This is happening because joy is withered away from the sons of men. So if we're looking at celestial fig trees and celestial figs, which I'm being led to think they are, because in Jude it's wandering stars, and we're getting stars being referred to as figs in Revelation. So if we're looking at celestial bodies here, the fig tree is languishing because the joy is withered away from the sons of men. So why is the joy being withered away from the sons of men? For me, verse 13 goes away to explain that. Gird yourself and lament, ye priests, how your ministers of the altar. And ministers are, well, angels are ministering spirits. We read that in Psalms and we read it in Hebrews. And when the Lord Jesus Christ, when he left the wilderness after being tempted of the devil, the angels ministered to him. And then the very next verse, he hears about John the Baptist. So I'm being led to think part of that ministering to him was they told him about John the Baptist. The angels were ministering to him. They're servants. They're servants of the Lord. And that's what the priests were. And to me, this is just another connection that we're looking at priests being celestial bodies, because angels are ministers. They're ministering spirits. They're ministering spirits. We read that quite a few times in the scriptures, and all of these connections I've been putting down with the Levites. This is just another one. This potentially for me connects the priests again, the untimely figs, to the fig tree, right? Ye ministers of the altar, come lay all night in sackcloth, ye ministers of my God, for the meat offering and the drink offering is withholden from the house of your God. So due to what the priests are doing, the Lord's ministers, I'm being led to think ministering spirits, celestial bodies, due to that, a celestial fig tree is languishing, and due to that, the joy is withered away from the sons of men. So the kingdom's been taken from them in Matthew. The Lord Jesus Christ tells us that. And the kingdom of heaven, it suffereth violence. And right through the scriptures in the Old Testament, we read prophecy that that Zion's going to be leveled. It's going to be absolutely destroyed. And it seems to me that where the children of Israel were in the Old Testament is exactly where the body of Christ are going. It's the same place, right? And it's not here. It's not here. So this is telling me that because of what's going on in the heavens, the state of the heavens, that has an absolute impact. That has an absolute impact on the sons of men, who I'm being led to think are earth dwellers, right? So the fig tree, Micah 4, right? Micah 4 is just, it just stopped me. But we get this one in Zechariah 3. Now, Zechariah for me is one enormous, enormous prophecy to the Lord Jesus Christ. And we're reading that Joshua, the high priest, is clothed with filthy garments. He's clothed with filthy garments, right? So when the redemption is complete, I'm being led to think that you are arrayed in white raiment. You've been washed clean. So Joshua, the high priest, so we get the priest again, right? He's clothed with filthy garments, and we've got Satan. He's standing by his right hand, right? Now, in verse 7, we read, "Thus saith the Lord of the celestial bodies," right? So we're back into the Lord of the celestial bodies. "If thou will walk in my ways, and if thou will keep my charge, then thou shalt also judge my house, and shalt also keep my courts, and I will give you the places to walk among these that stand by," right? So the Lord of the celestial bodies is calling. He's calling for judgment. He's calling for judgment, right? So back in Leviticus 19, these entities that I'm being led to think have the capability of being talebearers, they're told to judge their neighbor, right? And we get it here again. They're told to judge their neighbor in righteous judgment. The Elohim, the congregation of the mighty in Psalm 82, are the Lord's judges. There's a problem going on in the Old Testament with judging, and I'm being led to think it is the heavens judging the earth. That's what I'm starting to see. "Hear now, O Joshua the high priest, thou and thy fellows that sit before thee, for they are men wondered at, for behold, I will bring forth my servant the branch." So this is talking about the Lord Jesus Christ, right? It's obviously the Lord Jesus Christ. "My servant, the branch," and it's in capital letters. For me, it's quite undeniable. We're talking about the Lord Jesus Christ. "For behold, the stone that I have laid before Joshua, upon one stone shall be seven eyes. Behold, I will engrave the engraving thereof, saith the Lord of the celestial bodies, and I will remove the iniquity of that land in one day." Now, "In that day, saith the Lord of the celestial bodies, shall ye call every man his neighbor under the vine and under the fig tree," right? So what's a neighbor? What's a neighbor? Because the Lord of the celestial bodies here is talking about every man and his neighbor under the fig tree. "You shall call every man his neighbor under the vine and under the fig tree." So it's thee again, right? We're back to thee, and it's not every man under his own. But to me, this is back to where it was in 1 Kings 4, where before joy was withered away from the sons of men, but we're getting this one vine, and we're getting this one fig tree, right? So Are the church the new figs on this fig tree? That's what I'm being led to think, that it's certainly possible, and we're getting judgment between a man and his neighbor, I'm being led to think, because that's what we're getting in verse 7. So in that day there's going to be righteous judgment between every man and his neighbour, as per the commandment in Leviticus 9. And in that day ye shall call every man his neighbour under the vine and under the fig tree. It's very, very hard. It's very hard to understand what's going on here, but this is where it's been led me for quite some time. And the fig tree, for me, the fig tree is giving us, and the vine, it's giving us some clues about, for me, the condition of man and sin, between man and the Lord, and between man and sin. It seems it's a good thing for every man to be dwelling under his own vine and his own fig tree, but we're also getting the singular one. We're also getting this singular vine and this singular fig. And are the figs, who are the figs now? Because we've got untimely figs that have been cast off this fig tree, and that fig tree is twice dead, plucked up from the roots. That's what it doesn't say the fig tree in Jude, and being led to think it potentially is. And that's what we get in Mark. We get in Mark that the fig tree is dead. And in Joel, it languishes. So I'm being led to think it's dead as well, right? And all the figs have been cast off, but we've got this new fig tree. We're reading about in Zechariah 3, under the vine and under the fig tree. So this is potentially, I'm being led to think, maybe the new one. And back here in Joel, this is the old one. So this is the one that's being condemned, potentially tied in with the Pharisees in Mark 11, maybe, and the fig tree in Revelation 6:13. This is what I say, this vine and this fig tree, that's the prophecy here in Micah 4. But they shall sit every man under his vine and under his fig tree. So it tells me that every man's got his own vine and his own fig tree, right? And we're talking about a man and his neighbour in Zechariah 3. And none shall make them afraid for the mouth of the Lord of the hosts, right? The Lord of the celestial bodies has spoken it. The Lord of the celestial bodies has spoken it, right? For all people will walk every one in the name of his God, right? Now, this goes to the division and the mark of the beast for me. For all people will walk every one in the name of his God, and we will walk in the name of the Lord our God forever and ever. So to me, that's the division. That's the division. You're either with the Lord Jesus Christ or you're without him. Or you're against him, sorry, and that's what this is pertaining to. This is pertaining about this is pertaining to the church, and this is pertaining to the gospel. The gospel being the law of God. So this is the division, and they're going to go their way, and we're going to go ours, because we've been drawn. We've been drawn by the Holy Spirit, and this is the last days. So is this where we are now, right? This really hit me, this scripture. For all people will walk in the name of his God, and we will walk in the name of the Lord our God forever and ever. Hallelujah and amen. In that day, saith the Lord, I will assemble her that halteth, and I will gather her that is driven out, and that I have afflicted. So this is what I say about time and pre-existing beings, because right through these scriptures, I read scripture that people have been cast out into strange nations, and they've been sent to serve gods of wood and stone. They've gone to serve strange gods. They've been afflicted, and they've been scattered to all the nations. And I read and I think, well, that's exactly what I feel like. I feel like I've been driven out, and now I'm on planet Babylon because of pre-existing beings, right? Are we pre-existing beings that had to be sent away to be redeemed? It's hard to know, but I see it right through, and that's what because this is what this is talking about, and it's talking about the last days, right? So it's the future. It's the future, and the Lord saying that he's going to assemble her that halteth and will gather her that is driven out, and her that I have afflicted. And I will make her that halted a remnant. So we get this remnant again, right? We get this remnant, and that's Revelation 12:17, the remnant of her seed. And we see the remnant right through these scriptures. So who's Micah talking about? Because if they've been driven out and it's the last days, that means they were there and now they're not there, but they're going to go back. And I can't see anybody, I don't see anybody who's had that journey in their life where they've been on Mount Zion, been driven out to a strange nation, and they've been drawn back. For me, we're born. We're born on planet Babylon, and then we're drawn to Mount Zion. But I don't see the first bit. But here, Micah, he's talking about the last days. So he's talking about the future, and this is after the Lord Jesus Christ has ascended. For me, this is talking about, this is the gospel. This is the church. This is clearly a prophecy to the church. So who's Micah talking about? Who's he talking about, right? And I will make her that halted a remnant, and her that was cast far off a strong nation. The church, right? So they've been cast off. They've been scattered into the utmost parts of the earth and the heaven, right? Which takes me back to Deuteronomy 30 and Nehemiah 1. And for me, that's who Michael's talking about here. He's talking about the scattered remnant that the Lord has redeemed by his mighty power that Nehemiah talks about in Nehemiah 1. And I will make her that halted a remnant, and her that was cast far off a strong nation, and the Lord shall reign over them in Mount Zion from henceforth forever and ever. So you can imagine what I was thinking, giving on doing this video at the moment when I read that. Because the Lord's going to reign over them in Mount Zion forever and ever. This is talking about the remnant. This is talking about the church, the seed of the woman, those who have got the testimony of Jesus Christ and keep the commandments of God, the outcome of our faith, the author and the finisher of our faith, who has started and finished this work within us. It's talking about the Hebrews coming into Mount Zion and the 144,000, because that's where they all are. That's where they all are, but this is the last days. Micah here is talking about the last days, and for me, this is what I say. I see this just aligns with my testimony. Micah 4 aligns with my testimony, apart from being cast off, but I'm here. I feel like a stranger and a pilgrim on the earth, as I'm sure you do. We're here, we're stuck here, seemingly, until the Lord Jesus Christ says it's time and we get to leave planet Babylon. So when were we cast out? How do we get here? Why are we here? Right. And thou, O tower of the flock, the stronghold of the daughter of Zion, unto thee shall it come, even the first dominion, the kingdom, shall come to the daughter of Jerusalem. Right. So is the daughter of Jerusalem the same as the daughter of Zion? I'm being led to think that potentially yes. And thou, O tower of the flock, the stronghold of the daughter of Zion, shall come unto thee. So remember that Jeremiah, from memory in Jeremiah 1, he was made a fenced city. I'm being led to think he was made a stronghold. It was referring to a person. The stronghold of the daughter of Zion. So this potentially, and we've got the tower again, right? The watchman guarding the souls of men. The tower of the flock, the church, right? The stronghold of the daughter of Zion. So this could be, well, talking about people, the body of Christ, who have been made now a defense city, right? Because the body of Christ have got a hedge about them, lest they put forth their hands to iniquity. And unto thee shall it come, even the first dominion, the kingdom, shall come to the daughter of Jerusalem, right? So the daughter of Jerusalem is going to be given the kingdom. The daughter of Jerusalem, right? But get this. This blew my mind. Now, why dost thou cry out aloud? Is there no king in thee? Is thy counselor perished? For pangs have taken thee as a woman in travail. So the daughter of Jerusalem has been given the kingdom. And I'm being led to think that this is the kingdom that was rent away from the Old Testament Israel by the Lord Jesus Christ in the parable of the vineyard that we read in the book of Matthew. So this is for me, this is the same kingdom. And now that kingdom has been given to the daughter of Jerusalem. And now pangs have taken thee as a woman in travail. So the daughter of Jerusalem is with child. So the daughter of Jerusalem is somebody's mother, right? The daughter of Jerusalem is somebody's mother because she's with child, and pangs. Pangs have taken upon her. Now get this. Being pain and labor to bring forth, O daughter of Zion. So I'm being led to think the daughter of Zion is the daughter of Jerusalem. Like a woman in travail, for now shalt thou go forth out of the city, and thou shalt dwell in the field. Right? So the daughter of Zion, the daughter of Jerusalem, is in labor. They're travailing in birth, and they've been sent forth out of the city, and shall dwell in the field, and thou shalt go even to Babylon, and there thou shalt be delivered. There the Lord shall redeem thee from the hand of thine enemies. It's just mammoth, man. It's just absolutely mammoth, because for me, this is making a direct connection to travailing in birth, to being and being delivered, as to being delivered from your bondage, as the body of Christ are. So we're delivered. We're redeemed, right? So the daughter of Zion, the daughter of Jerusalem, has been scattered to Babylon, and I'm being led to think that's where we are. We're on planet Babylon, and now the Lord Jesus Christ is delivering us, and the Lord Jesus Christ is redeeming us. And in Nehemiah 1, Nehemiah says, these are they who thou hast redeemed by thy mighty power. And that's who Moses is talking about in Deuteronomy 30, I'm being led to think, and potentially the Lord Jesus Christ in Matthew 24, where he's going to gather the elect from the four corners of the heaven. And the Hebrews, in Hebrews 12, they're the first fruits, the firstborn, and they're being brought into Mount Zion, and the 144,000, they're on Mount Zion, and they're the first fruits that are not defiled with women, which connects back to Matthew 22. So this is what I say. I look at this, and all of this in Micah 4 just aligns with my testimony. It aligns with my testimony, except I can't articulate where I was scattered. I can't articulate when I was sent to Babylon. But I'm here. If that's where we are. It seems that's where we are. It feels like that's where we are. Because Babylon for me is when the whole world is united under Lucifer. Lucifer's the king of Babylon, I'm being led to think. Satan, whether they're the same or not, they're the king of Babylon. And that's where we are now. This is Satan's world. The Lord Jesus Christ, we read that in Matthew 4, when he shows the Lord Jesus Christ all the kingdoms of the world. The prince and the power of the air, the prince of this world. He's Satan's being given, I'm being led to think he was given dominion in Genesis 3, when mankind sinned in the Garden of Eden, and the keys to the kingdom, as it were given to Satan. He was given potentially flesh, because I see that as well, that Satan attacks the flesh. He did it to Job only after the Lord told him he could. And Paul says it as well, that he delivers people to Satan for the destruction of the flesh. So Satan potentially is controlling the flesh. Maybe, right? But that's where I'm being led to think we are now. We're absolutely in Babylon. We're in planet Babylon. And now we're getting delivered as the Lord redeems us, right? So this is what I say, Micah 4, I read this morning. And this is why I'm going to start Micah again tomorrow. As it just blew my mind. I'm still reverberating. It's just been amazing. So here, we're absolutely getting this separation, though. We're getting this separation, those who were with the Lord, because this is a prophecy to the church, right? This is a prophecy to the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'm seeing connections as well with the second house as well. So this is what I say. There's something about time coming in hard and also potentially us being pre-existing beings. Because who was Moses talking to in Deuteronomy 30? I'm being led to think he was talking to these people. Because the connection to Nehemiah 1 and Matthew 24. I'm being absolutely led to think that Moses was talking about these people here. He was talking about the church. He was talking about the church, right? So there's something about time and being pre-existing beings coming in hard in these scriptures that is very, very, very hard to grasp. Very hard to grasp. But in any case, as I say, we're seeing this separation between those who are with the Lord Jesus Christ and those who are against the Lord Jesus Christ. We've got a definite division going on in these scriptures. But we read it here in Revelation 13. I'll pick it up at 7. And it was given unto him to make war with the saints. Now, this now becomes significant as well, because who are the saints? Right through Paul's epistles, in every one where he's addressing a collection of people, you've got the Romans, you've got the Corinthians, the Galatians, Ephesians, the Church of Philippi, all of them apart from the Thessalonians are directly addressed to the saints. The word saints comes up in Thessalonians twice, but for me, it doesn't go to that. That's who he's addressing. I'm not saying that they're not the saints in the Church of Thessalonica, but there's a real difference. There's a real difference made with the Church of Thessalonica where they're not directly addressed as saints from Paul, right? So who are the saints? Are they the Hebrews? Are they the saints? Are the saints the Hebrews, and are all the saints in the 144,000, or are there some saints who aren't in the 144,000, and are there all the saints are in the body of Christ, right? All the saints would be in the body of Christ, so there's no saints outside of the body of Christ. So if all are in the body of Christ, are they all saints? Are the saints the 144,000? These are the questions, right? These are the questions. They're very, very exciting questions. And I feel, not only because I've been talking about musicians and Moses and harps and the like, not only that, but because of my testimony right now, what's going on here on the New South Wales Central Coast, that I've been led back here again to talk about these things. It's marvellous. And it was given unto him to make war with the saints and overcome them. And power was given him over all kindreds and tongues and nations. So this is interesting as well, because the beast here is going to overcome the saints. He's going to overcome them. So that does that pertain to us today? If we're the saints, if the body of Christ is the saints, are they? Because if the beast is going to overcome the saints, well, does that mean the saints have prevailed over the beast? Because he's going to overcome them. So what does overcome mean? What does overcome mean? Right? So we'll have a look at the word overcome. It's Greek word G3528. We see it the 28 times. Overcome, conquer, prevail, get the victory. To conquer, to carry off the victory, come off victorious. Of Christ, victorious over all his foes, right? So that's this word here. That's this word here. So the beast is going to overcome the saints. He's going to overcome them. And this word's being used of Christians that hold fast their faith, even unto death, against the power of their foes and temptations and persecutions. When one is arraigned or goes to law to win the case, maintain one's case. So it's to be victorious. And when a stronger than he shall come upon him and overcome him. I have overcome the world. So it's talking about the Lord Jesus Christ. Be not overcome with evil. So it's victorious. It's absolutely being victorious. And here in Revelation 13, this beast is going to make war with the saints and he's going to conquer them. Be victorious. So what could this mean and who could this be pertaining to? And power was given him over all kindreds and tongues and nations, and all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him, whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. So this is that separation that I'm talking about again. So I read this, and for me, it's a point of difference that if you're worshipping the beast, you are not written in this book of life. So when I read the rest of Revelation 13, I'm being led to think that that's defined by the mark of the beast. That's defined by the mark of the beast. So the scriptures are leading me to think that if you're at the end, which I'm absolutely seeing potentially that we are, if you're at the end and you take the mark of the beast, you're not written in the book of life. And to me, I'm pretty confident that we all of us already know that. So it's a point of difference. So if we're in these last times, these final events, which to me it seems that we could well be, as I go on, it's getting willing here on the New South Wales Central Coast. It's just getting next level every day. They keep finding more of these cases, and they're just pretend numbers, but it seems we're getting hundreds of cases every day. I've just seen an article, because I'm watching this now, as I put down this part of this video, it's July 17 now, and it's about 10 o'clock in the morning, 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock in the morning, and it's a Saturday here on the New South Wales Central Coast. And I've just seen a news article where the head of the CSIRO, there's something to do with health or something here in Australia, they're calling for a tougher lockdown, and otherwise this outbreak will be out of control. And I'd like to see that. I want to see what out of control actually looks like. Because there sure ain't any evidence of any boogie happening still. There's no evidence. I'm seeing no... It's the healthiest I've seen the Central Coast in all my life. There's no one sick. I can't remember the last time I saw anybody ill. It could be that they're staying at home because they're petrified. They're petrified of people seeing them. But I'm not... Normally you hear the little ones. During winter, you hear the little ones. They get that really throaty cough that the little ones get. You think, oh, you've got your first real cold there, little one, right? I'm not hearing that at all. I'm not hearing little ones with sniffles. I'm not hearing people coughing, sneezing. I'm not hearing any of it. I'm not seeing any manifestation of this at all. It's long settled, right? It's long settled that it's not true, but this doesn't mean that people aren't going to start dying, because that's what they've got now. They've got a license. They've absolutely just got an open license now that people are going to perish, and they can just blame it on the boogie and people are just going to believe it, right? So what does out of control actually look like? Because it's either they program us, so either we're going to get tough, because we're in what they call this lockdown, right? And it's very, very strict here. It's very strict. And I've got to be very, very... how do I say, smart and shrewd with the decisions I make. Mum made the analogy there yesterday, so I was trying to explain it to Mum that, yeah, we're brave. We're brave in the truth, but we've still got to make good decisions. And Mum said, yeah, she says, you can't tie yourself to the train tracks and ask God to save you, right? I said, perfect, Mum. That's absolutely perfect. So we've still got to make good decisions, right? And I don't... How can they get any tougher here? They can. And to me, they've inflicted this upon everybody, but the case numbers continue to go up, so it's not working, right? So it's pretty obvious what's going to happen. They're going to make, for me, They're going to create new stories out of nothing, where they're going to blame some rogue people and they're responsible for it because they're not following the rules. So because they haven't followed the rules, now we need to be tougher. The rules would work if you just follow them, right? And people aren't following them. They're going to make up these stories. And I see everybody around here are following them. I'm not. I just went down to a coffee shop here and I call it the Tower of Nonsense. You walk into these shops now and you're greeted with the Tower of Nonsense. It's just sitting there. You've got this beeping code thing and the hand sanitizer standing there and it's got all these rules written on. I just walk straight past it. I just walk straight past it, you know, the Tower of Nonsense. But Pete, I saw another guy after me. He walks in and I'm not judging him at all, right? Because he hasn't been blessed. He hasn't been woken up like we have. And to me, I'm like, well, how would I be behaving? How would I be behaving if I wasn't awake? I was praying about that very thing today and I know I'd be angry. I would be rancid right now and I'd be drinking and I would be angry. I would be absolutely furious right now with what's going on and I don't feel one shred of anger. How good is that, right? Not one shred of anger. I'm perplexed in a way, but not perplexed in another. It all has to be, right? It all has to be. But you can't help but be anxious. You can't help be anxious because of those scriptures that I'm about to go through in Revelation, because I'm seeing in another chapter later on in Revelation where we read about this beheading, and I'm seeing potentially that this could pertain to this overcoming them. And it's indeed made me nervous about what could be coming for us because it's all in scripture and it's all a part of overcoming the mark of the beast. It's made me quite nervous. And I'm going to go through, it's the plan anyway, to go through these scriptures in just a sec. So I want to share just a quick, I'll call it a testimony, of just something that I've seen the last couple of days. So I went down to see Mum and Dad yesterday. And I try to get down there at least once a week because I basically can't go and have cuppas with Mum anymore like I did at the shops. You just can't do it. It's not a matter of being afraid of them. It's like you can't tie yourself to the train tracks and ask God to save you, right? They've said it's illegal to go and do these things and you literally cannot sit down. There's no chairs. You can't go and sit down and they've got security guards at those shopping centres who are hurrying people along. They're hurrying people along. They won't let pensioners sit down. And all of these security staff, all of these police officers, they're very, very good at keeping people safe. They're doing their job with a great deal of relish and a great deal of enthusiasm. And the passion they feel to keep us safe is just overwhelming. And I feel so very blessed. So when I go to the shops, I know there's going to be people there itching to keep me safe. And it's not the place for me, right? So I don't go there. I'm not going to these places. And I'm very, very limited right now with what I can do. But what I've seen, I've got a Bible verse today. I'll just go grab it. It comes from Proverbs 20. So it's in the big calendar. It's in the big calendar that Mum gave me. So Saturday, the July 17, 2021. I can't look at the Sunday one. This is the only Bible verse I get on a Sunday because the small calendar from Mum and the Psalm calendar from Mum, They've only got the one for the weekend. I don't know why they do that. You only get the one scripture for the weekend, but this one you get the two. So I've got to make sure I don't look at the bottom one, right? I can't look at the bottom one. So I'm going to cover it right as I read this out. But it comes from Proverbs 20:22. Say not thou, I will recompense. Now I've had a look at that word recompense, and it seems to pertain to be at peace with, to be at one with. You're cleaving yourself. It's a recompense. Say not thou, I will recompense evil, but wait on the Lord and he shall save thee, right? So that's the message that I'm getting right now is, so don't recompense evil. So for me, I look at that and I think, well, I'm certainly not at peace with evil, but I don't want to participate in it either. And there's another scripture I remember from Proverbs where it says, the wise man hides himself in the day of, and the fool goes out and about, and to the like. I put it up on the screen, and right now I'm just thinking to myself, I need to be patient. I just need to wait on the Lord, and I'm still doing what I need to do. Whenever I need to go to the shops, I walk in, and I don't participate in that nonsense, and just act normally. But I'm not going out looking. I only do things if I absolutely need to, because I want to get to the end of this without having any contact with anybody whatsoever. I don't. I was saying to someone there the other day that my main two priorities, these aren't my priorities, right? But this is what I tell the world. My priority is to keep finding the Holy Spirit, keep seeking the Holy Spirit's face, and to continue to grow in this gospel, and to edify my brothers and sisters that come forward on this channel, and that I'm so blessed to have watched, and also be led by the Spirit as I go about my day-to-day life. They're my main priorities in life now, right? But when I speak to people who haven't been led to witness the truth to, I say to them, my main two priorities, and these are my fleshly priorities right now, is that I don't want to be arrested, and I don't want to be identified with what they call a hotspot. I don't want to be identified, right? So I'm laying very, very low, right? So waiting on the Lord, and I feel that's what that scripture could pertain to me at this very moment on July 17, 2021. It's extraordinary what's going on, and they're not going backwards. They're not going backwards to me. They're full steam ahead. I noticed they've inflicted it now on Melbourne. I saw a news story there last night where all Victoria, by the looks, are in it. And I saw a news story there last night where the Queensland Premier was in estimates committee or something. I put it up where she just burst out laughing. She could not stop laughing. She just couldn't help herself. A laughing fit, they were calling it. And I was saying to Mum, like, they're all corrupt, right? All these politicians are corrupt. And I was saying to Mum yesterday that I remember when the Queensland floods happened. So I was living in Queensland. I was actually in Manila at the time, but I was living in Queensland at the time of the floods. I was in Manila for 6 months, and the floods happened while I was over there. So I was based in Brisbane at the time. And I remember Anna Bligh, the Queensland Premier back then, they're all in on it, right? But she seemed to me to show some genuine emotion. She was shedding tears because it was horrible, those Queensland floods. It was absolutely brutal. And so much devastation, so much death, and so people just lost everything. So many heartbreaking stories. And she was physically distressed. And I would have thought, if we're in this, what they're saying right now, if it was true, you would have a New South Wales Premier and an Australian Prime Minister who are just bursting at the seams with sadness for their people. But I'm not seeing it. I'm not seeing one ounce of sadness. They come out and they say, it's with a heavy heart that I say this today, and it's just pure nonsense, and we know it's pure nonsense, right? And not one, I'm not seeing one emotion that indicates to me that they're at all distressed. It's like they've been prepared for it. They're all handling it so well. They're all handling it so well. I even look at that Winston Churchill, right? Obvious Freemason, obviously in on it. But the role he played in World War II is that he stirred that nation to arms. He stirred those people, right? It's true. That's what happened to me. That's what I see, that he stirred that nation. He stirred them with emotion, and they followed him. I'm not seeing it here now. I'm just seeing brutal dictators who are just inflicting rules, and there's not one piece of empathy, and there's not one piece of sadness in their souls. And you can see it. You'll know them by their fruits, right? You'll know them by their fruit. So I'm laying low. That's my plan right now, is I'm laying low, and so far it's working, and I feel a good amount of peace. I feel good. I feel really, really good. I had the most amazing prayer this morning, and we're feeling good. I say to the Holy Spirit, I feel like I've got some clear air. Now, this is the other thing I want to say, and to him goes all the glory for that. How can you have clear air in this environment now? I do. I feel good. I feel blessed. It's very windy here. It's very, very windy. So I live in an old place here, and yesterday parts of my roof started to fall off. So you probably hear a lot of noise in the background, and that's my roof creaking. And I've got a man coming today apparently to look at my roof, so I might have men walking on my roof, but I'm hoping that I won't be recording by then. But they're due now, so they could come at any time, right? So you can hear my roof creaking, and it's not fun here right now. It's like I feel my roof could actually blow off at any moment. So that's the noise that you potentially hear in the background, and it's extremely windy. It's not pleasant out there at all. Now, this is what happened at Mum's yesterday. So this fella here, Adam Crouch MP, the member for Terrigal, right? So he's a local member of parliament. Now, and that's state government. Here in Australia, we've got three levels of government. Right? We've got local government, the council, and we've got the state government, and then we've got the federal government. And it's Gladys is the premier. So this guy, he's the local member for Terrigal, which is not where I am, but it's very close. Now, he released this. You can see here, like, they're all part of it, right? They're all part of it. You can see here with the orange. Orange, I believe, is the only number that adds up to 33 in numerology. For me, orange is a real colour to look for. Like, orange is not a colour people should be wearing in this role, I don't think. I don't think it looks at all good for a man to be wearing an orange tie. I think ties are ridiculous. I just think they're a choke around people's neck. The person that ever invented the tie should... I don't understand ties. I've never understand ties and suits. And you can probably say, by the way, I dress that. I dress to be comfortable. But you can see straight away that for me, they're in on it, right? He's a local MP. He's a politician. He's in on it. Now, Mum brought this to my attention yesterday. So you can see, and it's Facebook, right? So I can see this. I don't have Facebook. You see, I have to log in, but I can see this page. So I can see this page, right? So this is his Facebook page. And you can see here that he's pushing the rugby league, he's pushing the football, and he's, you know, decked out in a face mask, and he doesn't need to wear a face mask here, but he needs to wear a face mask here. It's all just ridiculous, all the contradictions, right? Now, he released this notification on the 13th of July. If the risk subsides and if we record no local cases over the next few days, I will fiercely advocate for the New South Wales Health to end the Central Coast's lockdown, right? So this was the 13th. Now, when I put down that my video to the Scattered Strangers greetings, my Mark of the Beast video, it was around that time. And I said on that video that there's been no local cases. But there are now, right? The Central Coast, I'll put it up on screen now, the Central Coast now have cases. But when he did this post, there was no cases, right? I support the Premier's lockdown decision because she has followed the health advice to the letter. Of course you do, right? Because you're not in it for the people, you're in it for your masters. While following the health advice, and we should be their masters because they're the servant, they're the public servant, but no. They're our masters on the earth. While following the health advice is our number one priority, your people should be, I am acutely aware of the impact this lockdown is having on our families, workers and businesses. So if you were acutely aware of that, your priority would be them, not the health advice. But you're not acutely aware because you don't care. Current New South Wales Health remains very concerned about a seeding event occurring on the New South Wales Central Coast region. Not sure what that seeding means. I haven't looked at that. However, if this risk does not subside and if we record no local cases over the next few days, I will fiercely advocate for the Premier and Creature Chant to end the... if we take this very seriously, right? That's her.
If we all take this very seriously.
Her that can't even clean her teeth properly. And to end the Central Coast... She's the health officer and she's got brown teeth, right? She's got brown teeth. And they just look horrendous. She just looks like she's got the most unhealthy mouth, and she's the health officer, and that's who we're taking our health advice here from on the New South Wales Central Coast. Kerry, if we take this very seriously, Chan.
If we all take this very seriously.
We do not want the lockdown to go one day longer than necessary, But if that was true, it wouldn't have gone for one day. That is why everyone must continue to stay at home and follow the rules, right? Because the rules are your number one priority, not your constituents, right? So it's full of contradictions. They're full of contradictions and they're full of hot air, but that's what he said, right? So I went to Mum's and Mum pointed this out. So my mother's waking up. It's marvellous. It's a wonderful thing. She's waking up and she's fully aware of this. She knows what's going on, right? And she just looked at me and she said, go and have a look at the front page of the local paper, son. So Mum's the only person that reads the Central Coast Chronicle. Nobody reads it, right? So this is dated the 14th of July, 2021. So we come back to this bloke's post. And he posts on the 13th, right? And there was no cases then. There were no cases on the Central Coast then. And he said, we are going to go and fiercely advocate that the Central Coast ends the lockdown, right? The lockdown ends for the Central Coast. We're going to fiercely advocate. This member of parliament who's the rules are his main priority, not his constituents, the rules and the health advice. That's his priority, not his constituents, right? So he posts this on the 13th. This comes out on the 14th. Whoa! Put everything on hold. It's been detected. The boogie's in the sewage. It's in the sewage. So they've detected the boogie in the sewage. So look out. Hold the presses. New South Wales. The New South Wales Central Coast. It must continue. Must continue. Presto! There it is. So no need. There's no need now for Adam Crouch MP to go and lobby for his constituents. There's no need because we've got the boogie in the sewage. It's just so, it's sickening. It's absolutely sickening to watch. And they're, it's in the sewage. They can detect it in the sewage. Are you serious? They're going to put it in the water next. I can feel it. They're going to say it's in the water and that's going to be the next test. Are they going to turn off the water to say it's unsafe? I can see it. I can feel it. They're going to say it's in the water. I can see it. It's just so dark here, man. It's so, so dark. So that's me right now, right? So what do you do? You just wait patiently. You just wait patiently on the Lord and that's what I'm doing. I'm just laying low and I just want to get through this and do my 10 pages a day, continue to do my videos and get to know the Holy Spirit more and more and just grow in this glorious gospel. And it's just heightening just my sense that we are in some extraordinary events here. And the fact that I've been led to these scriptures in Revelation and I'm indeed starting to get some more understanding in them. And the plan is to have a look at the first resurrection and these scriptures in Revelation. That's the plan for the next little bit on this video. So to be led here right now to be talking about these things, not because I want to be right, not because I want to understand. It's where the Holy Spirit's led me because of my videos and my testimony. It's a glorious thing. So I'm learning more about the mark of the beast and who's not going to take them and whoever I'm blessed enough to have watched these videos, we're all going to learn together. Isn't it a wonderful thing? Isn't it a wonderful thing as I endure this, what they call a lockdown? He's amazing. He is an amazing God, the Holy Spirit. So let's keep going, right? Let's keep going. And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him, whose names are not written in the book of life, the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world, right? So this is interesting because when we actually read about the mark of the beast, I find this very interesting because we see this word all and there's no whose names are not written in the book of life, right? There's nothing here. But because we read this up here, I'm being led to think that it applies to down here. Because we absolutely read in other scripture that some do not take the mark of the beast. But we read in verse 16, and he calleth all, right? Both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, right? Free and bond. free and bond, right? So it's fascinating stuff to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads, and that no man might buy or sell save he that had the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. Right, so all he calls a thought. But back up in verse 8, we're reading, and he calls all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him whose names are not written in the book of life. Right, but in verse 16, we're not getting whose names. We're not getting that at all. It just says all. And I read this word free and poor, and I think, well, that for me is describing the church. So that's what it says, right? That's what it says. But when we come into Revelation 14, Revelation 14 for me is an absolute desolate scene for the people who actually received the mark of the beast, right? The same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation, and he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. And the smoke of their torment ascendeth up for ever and ever, and they have no rest day or night, who worship the beast and his image, and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name. Here is the patience of the saints, right? So here we are with the saints again. Here are they that keep the commandments of God, Revelation 12, 17, the seed of the woman, and have the faith of Jesus. So this for me absolutely connects the saints. The saints will not take the mark of the beast. And this tells me that every single last one of the saints will not take the mark of the beast. And we come back into Revelation 13. And as I say, we're getting a difference made. You've either taken the mark of the beast or you haven't taken the mark of the beast. So for me, every single person who does not take the mark of the beast is a saint. That for me is what we're getting here in Revelation 14. Anybody who does not take the mark of the beast, they're a saint. And we read, here are they that keep the commandments of God. So we come into Revelation 12. And for me, that absolutely connects as well, that those who keep the commandments of God, they're the saints. They're the saints, and they're also the seed of the woman, because the seed of the woman, the remnant of her seed, the seed of the woman, I'm being led to think the seed of Christ that we read about in Galatians 3, they keep the commandments of God, and they have the testimony of Jesus Christ. So the only way you can do this is to have that, right? So the remnant of the seed of the woman, I'm being led to think the church, the woman being Israel, I'm being led to think the remnant of her seed is the church, and they keep the commandments of God because they have the testimony of Jesus Christ. And we come back into Revelation 14, and the saints, they keep the commandments of God because they have the testimony of Jesus Christ, because they're the seed of the woman. They're the remnant of the woman's seed. So this for me gives me confidence that we can absolutely connect, and we can absolutely be confident that every single last one of the saints will not take the mark of the beast, and every single one of those are written in the book of life. You can, if you do not take the mark of the beast, you're a saint. So I now look at that and I think, well, every single person within the church will not take the mark of the beast. I'm not seeing it's possible where you can take the mark of the beast and be in the church. The Lord Jesus Christ isn't going to allow it. There's a scripture here in Matthew 24 that I find fascinating, because it's always got me, this one, because I think, well, how can this be possible? Matthew 24, 24, right? For there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, and they shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect. So how can the elect be deceived? Is that possible? Is that possible? I look at this, if it were possible. they shall deceive the very elect. So it's not possible, right? Can the elect be deceived? Is the Holy Spirit going to allow the elect to be deceived? So I look at this and I think, well, potentially that's what's going on here. It's actually not possible. It's not possible. It's not possible that you can deceive the elect, right? So for me now, I now look at Revelation 14, because Revelation 14 starts off. It starts off about the 144,000. And then we come into verse 6, and I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, to enter every nation and kindred and tongue and people. So we come back into Matthew 24, and Shay, you left me a comment, and it was actually on the second channel. Now, it's now the next day. It's now the next day, and it's Sunday. It's Sunday, July 18, and the man didn't come to... Don't be alarmed. Don't be alarmed. It is me, but it's extremely cold here this morning. And the man did not come to fix my roof yesterday. And he said, because it was too windy, and it's just a beautiful winter's day out there today. It's freezing cold. But he said, because it was so windy, he's going to come back tomorrow. So I'm expecting him to be here today. So I want to try and get down the recording before he arrives. So hence my strange apparel, right? Because it's extremely cold, and it's now Sunday. It's Sunday, July 18, 2021. It's about 7 o'clock in the morning here on the New South Wales Central Coast. And I thought, because I was talking about this yesterday, I was putting my hand over it to cover it. I thought I might share the Bible verse of the day today. It comes from Luke 6:16. Not very well lit in here, and it's still quite dark, so it's hard to see. It looks like Luke 6:16, it might be 36. I'll put it up on screen. Be ye therefore merciful, as your Father is also merciful. So it's just amazing that during what's going on here, currently on the New South Wales Central Coast, and what about Gladys doing the 666, right? That literally happened as I was processing the video. I just wanted to get some footage of Gladys talking and just to articulate what I was saying about how she's just stone cold in her demeanor. There's just no empathy for the people at all. There's no emotion. There is nothing. It's just a cold-hearted, brutal dictator who's just inflicting more rules, right? And she flashes out the 666 at that moment. So that press conference had only just happened. So it's dark. It's real, real dark. And that Kerry chant.
If we all take this very seriously.
Like, she's the health officer. And, like, we don't obsess about people's appearance and stuff. But if she's the health officer and she can't even... If she's got a mouth that just looks like it's got fungus coming out of it. I'm sorry, I'm not taking health advice from you. And... they're clearly not like us, and I think Kerry, I look at Kerry and I think Kerry probably, I think you know what I'm trying to say about Kerry. It's a very neutral type name, isn't it? It's a very neutral type name that could apply.
If we all take this very seriously.
To many different people. In any case, we'll get back to the comment from Shay. So this was most profound, brother, and this is for me is what edification within the body of Christ is all about. It's not just agreeing with each other, and it's not just making each other feel good. There's a bit of making, we need to pop each other up when we lift each other up. That's the word I'm after, when we're down and when we're having hard times. But we don't just say things that people need to hear, you know. We need hard truths if necessary, but we're here to edify each other. We're here in love, and we just want what's best for each other. But sometimes, and this is how I'm seeing it works too, is that sometimes we just make a comment and we're not even trying. We're not even trying. It's just a comment. We're just fellowshipping. It's just a comment. You just go, you did not seriously say that. Are you serious? Did you just say that? And I find that a lot with my precious brothers and sisters who I'm so blessed to have come forward, that that actually contribute a comment to my videos. I feel so blessed to each and every one comment that I get. Sometimes I find it a lot. You'll just say something and I just go, wow, that's just connected something for me. And Shay, you did this the other day because I don't struggle with why are we still here, but I do wonder, because the Lord Jesus Christ, it's a finished work. It is finished. He defeated sin on the cross, but evil still prevails. To me, prevails. To me, well, it still reigns, it's not prevailing, but it's here it is. It's just going on unabated. They've just got free reign right now here in the New South Wales Central Coast. They can do whatever they want, and it's pretty much become a police state. It's pretty much come police state. I was actually going to go and do something there yesterday, but I thought better of it because I thought there might be a police roadblock. And what they're looking for is people leaving their houses. Like, if that's not a police state, I don't know what it is. We're pretty much in a police state here now. And it's like I go and see my parents, I'm committing a sin in their laws. I'm not saying it's against the law because it's not, but it's against their rules. So they'll interpret as being against the law for me to go and see my mum and dad. And I'm not telling them where I'm going. If they say to me, where are you going? I say, well, I'm not telling you. You've got no right to know where I'm going. I've done nothing wrong, so I don't want you in my business. I'm not telling you. And I fully expect to get myself into trouble with them if I bump into them, right? So I don't want to bump into them because I don't want trouble, right? So it's getting hard. It's getting really, really hard here. So I can't remember how I got there. But anyway, we'll get to the comment. And Shay, you said, I was talking about why are we still here? Because sin is prevailing. Sin's just prevailing here unabated. Why are we still here? Like, the Lord Jesus Christ defeated it, but sin still prevails. So why are we still here? Why are we still here? And I've been talking about that with Shay. And he said this the other day, and it just blew my mind. So he's sharing a testimony with his uncle that died, and how he saw similarities in his uncle with himself. So I'll pick it up where we've got I'll read the whole thing out. Thanks, brother. My bro just informed me that was my dear parents' wedding song. I was thinking about the questions posed in your last comment, brother, and I do have the same pressing feeling about us still being here. Wherever here is exactly. Yeah, exactly. Where are we? My dear uncle, who I shared many similarities with, passed on last year from cancer, and I spoke at his funeral. It was hard, but it did feel he had come full circle and was moving on to be both with the Father and the Son. I must say, it had a profound impact on me, brother, as I could see in his eyes that his spirit was already with God and he was heading home, right? So I just feel so blessed to be having somebody here talking like this.
Heaven and earth will disappear, but my words remain forever. But no one knows the date and hour when the end will be, not even the angels, no, nor even God's Son. Only the Father knows. The world will be at ease, banquets and parties and weddings, just as it was in Noah's time before the sudden coming of the flood. People wouldn't believe what was going to happen until the flood actually arrived and took them all away. So shall my coming be. Two men will be working together in the fields, and one will be taken, the other left. Two women will be going about their household tasks, one will be taken, the other left. So be prepared, for you don't know what day your Lord is coming.
Life was filled with guns and war, and everyone got trampled on the floor. I wish we'd all been ready. Children died, the days grew cold. A piece of bread could buy a bag of gold. I wish we'd all been ready. There's no time to change your mind. The sun has come, you've been left behind. You've been left behind.